Good to see you in the Lord's house this morning. Each one of you has gathered here today at Tiff Tony Baptist Church. Those online, we thank you for also watching this morning. Let's get you hymn books. Let's turn to page number 11. Page number 11. Everyone standing together, sing this great hymn. I sing the mighty power of God. Page number 11. Everyone standing, let's sing together. I sing the mighty power of God that made the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad and built the lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at His command, and all the stars obey. I sing the goodness of the Lord that filled the earth with food. He formed the creatures with His word, and then pronounced them good. Lord, how the wonders are displayed standing, please.
Amen, and all God's people said, welcome to Tiftonia Baptist Church. I have to say, I think this is the best crowd we've had in about a year and a half. Somebody say amen. Man, it's good to see all of y'all here. Could we make this a regular occurrence on Sunday? And thank God for all of you for being here, and we appreciate all of you being here today. Let's pray. Let's ask God's blessing on our service. Before we do, though, I want to just kind of give a prayer request, but also a praise. Miss Marcia's granddaughter, Samantha, was kicked by a horse yesterday, but she did go to the hospital, but nothing internally. So she's going to be very sore, but we're praising the Lord that nothing very serious could have been. So we're thankful for that. So continue to pray for her. And then I also want to remind you of this. If you notice in the back, the post office in the back, that was supposed to be our Christmas post office. It is now February, and we still have some folks' calendars back there, and some folks still have some cards. What I'm going to ask you to do, if you'd go back as you leave today, look at the table. If there's someone's name there that you know or could help me deliver those, there may be your neighbor, or you can get that to them, would you please pick that up and take that to them today or sometime this week? That'd be a great blessing, all right? Let's pray together. Let's ask the Lord's blessing on our service. All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your goodness and grace. Lord, we're thankful for your love, your kindness to us. But Lord, we come to you today knowing what needs to take place in this building today. No man can do it. So Lord, we're asking you to do what only you can do. Speak to our hearts. Lord, I pray you'll help us today to realize that life really isn't much worth living without the peace that you give. So, Lord, I do pray that you'll speak to all of our hearts. We thank you for the one today that's following you in believer's baptism. Lord, I pray you'll bless him. And Lord, we thank you for his obedience in that command. And Lord, we just ask that you'll bless. Again, have your way in this service. We give it to you. We ask it all in the precious name of the Lord Jesus. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good to see each one of you here this morning, and we especially want to welcome our visitors here today. God bless you for being here. Normally, we'd be giving out cards and so forth, but anyhow, you're only a visitor once, and so we want you to come back. If you haven't been here in a while, please come back. You're always welcome. We praise the Lord for you being here, and if we can do anything for you, please let us know. Also, as we look forward to our coming days here, I call these opportunities to serve the Lord. And we have several opportunities to do that. And so let's do that as we look here. You got your bulletin and others. But coming up here, as we are looking each service this month, and we're all halfway through it, is Home Improvement Month. Every service is about the home and our relationships with the Lord and others. And they've been good all through this month. And you don't want to miss a service. So be here tonight, back at 6 o'clock. Be here Wednesday night, 7 o'clock. And be ready in our services here. And if you can't be here, be online, and we appreciate that. Also, coming up here at the beginning of March is the marriage retreat. And if you're still wanting to go on that, sign up for that. The rooms for the church has already been done, but you're also welcome on that. So remember, that's Thursday and Friday, March 4th and 5th, the marriage retreat up in Pigeon Forge. Tuesday, March 9th, is the next Ladies Fellowship. Ladies, there's a sign-up sheet in the back there. Table for food, so if you would sign up for that, please do that. And then March 20th is our next men's prayer breakfast, and then on March 28th through the 31st is our spring revival with Brother Pastor Dallas Payton, and we're looking forward to that. So let's remember that. Also, as you leave this morning, you're welcome to give your tithes, your faith promise, your the building fund. Please give unto the Lord as part of our worship to Him. There'll be offering plate in the back. Also, for your convenience, online, there will also be a place there that you can give and see what to do there online. So if you'd like to do it that way, please do so. But let's give, and give because we love the Lord and love what God is doing here, and also to support our missionaries around this world. At this time, I ask everyone to stand. Let's turn to page 612, page number 612. We'll dismiss the junior church, ages 4 through the 5th grade. You walk out quietly. Let's sing He Keeps Me Singing, page 612, ages 4 through the 5th grade, junior church. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and love. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name known, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Last verse, soon He's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Thank you. You may be seated. Right before the message this morning, Brother Mike is going to come with a special, please.
How long has it been since you talked with the Lord and told Him your heart's hidden secrets? How long since you prayed? How long since you stayed on your knees till the light shone through? How long has it been since your mind felt at ease? How long since your heart knew no burden? Can you call Him am your friend. How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? How long has it been since you knelt by your bed and prayed to the Lord up in heaven? How long since you knew that he'd answer you and would keep you the long night through? How long has it been since you woke with the dawn and felt that the day's worth the living? And you call him your friend. How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you? Can you call him your friend? How long has it been since you knew that he cared for you?
Aren't you glad this morning he cares for you? And he does. I'm thankful. Isn't it amazing that he can love the unlovable? And you say, well, how do you know he can love the unlovable? Because I'm pretty unlovable. He loves me. I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful that all of you are here today. Great encouragement to look out here, see all the children, see all of you. And I normally don't do this, but you know, Brother Dellen is going to get baptized today, and I want to make this clear. Baptism has nothing to do with salvation. Nothing. Baptism has nothing to do with salvation. There is no water on earth, or even if someone blesses it or prays over it, can wash away sin. Only the precious Lord Jesus can wash sin away. And you meet the Lord Jesus Christ by putting your faith and trust in him as a simple child would. And I'm thankful years ago, I did not know Dellen. He called me. There was some things that went on in his life. Didn't know him, never met him. He called me. And he was troubled in soul, and he called and asked me if I'd come. And I went to where he lived. I went and sat down with him, talked very short while I realized he was very serious about knowing that he needed to get things where he needs to get things with the Lord. And I was privileged to be there the day that he got assurance of his salvation. And I'm thankful for that. But because after someone gets saved, you're saved by putting your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, but then a step of obedience is to obey the Lord in baptism. It's an obedience to the Lord's command. It's to identify with the Lord Jesus. Now, we're going to bring the children in here a little bit when we baptize them because we want the children to understand this. When you walk into a baptistry, there's water in that baptistry. That water is about waist deep. Probably to Dellen, it's going to be probably less than that. It'll be maybe chest deep to me. It's going to be, y'all pray that I don't have to double dip him. Because there's two that's the double dip club here. They were very large men, and I couldn't get them down all the way the first time, so I had to, and then bring them up. But that water crosses your body like the cross crossed Jesus' body. You're lower down in that water as Jesus Christ, when he gave up his ghost and gave his life, he was put in a tomb. But praise God, he was only in there 3 days. So when we bring you up, by the way, I've never drowned anybody. That's not scriptural baptism. Scriptural baptism is being immersed in water. Listen to me now. That's why it's important that you're immersed in water. Because it's a picture that the Lord Jesus was put in a tomb.
But praise God, he victoriously raised up out of that tomb. If he did not do that, we could not have hope. And so we bring him up out of that water because the Lord Jesus came up out of that tomb. And it's a picture of what the Lord Jesus has done for us when someone gets baptized. Plus, I'm going to be honest with you now, I've never known the Lord to bless like he really wants to bless unless a child is really willing to obey his commands. And so this is something he asks us to do. We do it out of obedience. And so we follow the Lord in obedience and baptism. So I'm very thankful. I also want to say, I'm not bragging on him, I'm just being honest. Dellen has been a great encouragement to me. I've been meeting with him, talking with him, and I appreciate that. And it's good when another man comes into your office and you can talk about spiritual things. And I've been very encouraged by his humility and his awareness of where he is and what he knows the Lord has to help him in his areas of his life. And we should all feel that way. We need his help, don't we? And I'm thankful the Lord will help us. Would you open the precious word of God? And so I say all of that, I'm going to try to finish early. Now, y'all know that absolutely means nothing. But I'm going to try to end early so we can have this baptism. We'll have a song so we can go in there and get ready. It will not take long. Just a couple of minutes, we'll be ready to baptize. And I want you to stick around for that to encourage him. And that'll be a great blessing. I also want to remind you quickly, if you'll open the Word of God to the book of James in the New Testament, the book of James, I want to say a couple of things. I appreciate all the visitors being here. We are in Home Improvement Month. The month of February is designated geared towards homes, relationships, and family. Every message that I preach through the whole month of February, Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, they're all geared towards the home. All of our messages are archived. You can get a CD for them, or you can watch them online on Sermon Audio, or you can also go to our Facebook page, our YouTube page, and you can watch these messages on the home. We've dealt with so many different aspects of relationships and home and family and children, all of those things. And today, I want to deal with a very important subject. And I pray the Lord will use it. Before we get there, I want to remind you now, we have our marriage conference. Our marriage retreat is coming up. Actually, it's going to be the first weekend in March. So we've only got a few days, really, a couple weeks, and we're going to be there. It's on a Thursday night. It begins at 6:30 on Thursday night at the River Plantation Conference Center. We've had this for years. It's a great complex. As of right now, we've got about 72 people total there. I've still yet to hear from two churches to find out how many they have coming. But I want to encourage you, if you would like to come to this, please let us know. You can get your own accommodations. We can help you with that, give you some thoughts. We provided accommodations for everyone that wanted to come and signed up with a discounted rate, but we've had to get that room list into the hotel. So that's no longer available. Maybe we could help you with that. But I want to encourage you, this would be a weekend that would be worth your time to come and get encouragement and help for your marriage. I want to make a statement. Marriages are not good because you don't put effort in them. If you ever let a relationship get in cruise control, you're in trouble. You can never put a relationship, because it's a very precious thing, a friendship, a marriage relationship, a family member's relationship with you. Listen, these are vital. Relationships are vital. You know as well as I do, relationships in life can make more life more joyful, but if those relationships are not where they need to be, there's nothing that makes more life more miserable than not maintaining relationships. And so, who created these relationships? Who designed them? God did. See, we're living in a day where we're trying to maintain and have relationships like we know what we're doing. We're going to set up the rules for these because we designed marriage. We came up with marriage. We came up with friendships. No, God came up with all of these relationships. And so I want you to know, God is the designer. He's the creator. He's also the maintainer of all of our relationships too. And I want to deal with a subject this morning that I hope will be helpful. If I don't get finished, it's fine. We'll finish tonight. But I want you to look in the book of James, chapter 4, and we'll read just a few verses here. And I pray the Lord will have His way in our hearts. I hope and pray that everyone will give us a few minutes and just listen. And not just listen with your ears, but listen with your heart and be open and willing to allow the Lord to speak to our hearts today. He wants to. The Bible says in James chapter 4, verse 1, "From whence come wars and fightings among you?" What a question. "From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lust that war in your members? Ye lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lusts. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Do you think that the Scripture saith in vain, the Spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? But He giveth more grace, wherefore He saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted." Now, this is an interesting verse. "Be afflicted and mourn and weep." That's an interesting verse. "Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up." Heavenly Father, we do come to you again this morning. We thank you for your goodness. And Lord, I'm asking you to do what I cannot do. Speak to our hearts. Help us now. In Jesus' name, amen. This passage starts out with the question of the ages. The question of the ages. From whence come wars and fightings? You know what he's asking there? Why is there so much fighting and conflict in today's life? Why is there so much fighting? Why is my mommy and daddy fighting? Why is churches fighting? Why is family members fighting and having conflict with one another? Why are they fussing? Y'all know what a good fuss is. How many of y'all ever been in a good fuss? Would you raise your hand? Now I'm going to find out whether you're going to lie in church or not. How many of you ever been in a good fuss? Would you raise your hand? The rest of you need to be on this altar this evening, this afternoon, because you're lying right here in church. If you ain't never had a good fuss, you ain't alive, and you're certainly not a normal human being. Because we're human. We're full of weakness. But this is the good question. Where's all this fighting come from? Why's mommy and daddy fussing? Why's this going on? Why's there conflict? Why's that family member mad at the other family member? Why's that church a fussing and a fighting? Why'd that preacher have to leave? Why'd that person leave the church mad? Those are good questions, and all of us have asked those questions. That's what James is asking here. Where in the world is all this fighting and conflict and fussing come from? Ain't that a good question? That's a good question I think all of us ought to ask, because there's certainly too much fighting and fussing and arguing in this day. But have you ever just thought about that question? Isn't that a good question? I'm going to tell you, it's not such a good question. I got a better answer. That's what the message is. This is a good question, but there's a better answer. Now, I want to just say, what is the source of the fights and the fighting and the conflict and the fussing? Why are children hurting other children? Why is social media being used today to hurt the very deepest people, the deepest organs of a man or a woman, the hurting of the heart? Saying words that doesn't bring life but bring death. Why is that taking place today? Why do we tend to hurt the ones we love? In the book of Love that Charles Dobson wrote, I read this the other day and I happened to notice something that I thought was interesting. James Dobson recorded an illustration that graphically described and demonstrates really how deeply that these issues are affecting people today. Because I'm going to be honest with you, church, when I was a little boy, if you would have asked me, he asked in this book, and he asked 30 children to finish the sentence, "I wish." And then he let those children answer that question and fill out that blank, "I wish." Now, I want you to know something. When I was a young boy in the 80s, if someone would have asked me to say, "I wish," I'm going to be honest with you, I would have put something like, and I'm being honest with you, I would have put something like, "I wish I was the next wide receiver of the Washington Redskins." Or, "I wish that I could go to Disney World." Or, "I wish that I could catch a big bass." Or, "I wish that I could kill a deer." I mean, that's the kind of stuff as a young boy in the 80s I would have wrote. Do you want to know what the responses of the 30 of these children were in this day? He asked them, he asked 30 sixth grade children to give their class a creative writing assignment. Each was asked to complete a sentence that began with the words, "I wish." 20 of the 30 sixth grade children made references that he wished something was better in their family. Can I read to you some of the responses? "I wish my parents wouldn't fight, and I wish my father could come back home. I wish my mother didn't have a boyfriend. I wish I could get straight A's so my dad would actually love me. I wish I had one mom and one dad so the kids wouldn't make fun of me. I wish I had an M1 rifle so I could shoot those who make fun of me." That's today. Why? We're doing it wrong, people. I know in this book, James is specifically talking about church. I understand the context of this passage. I've read it hundreds of times, and I've never preached this way before out of this passage. But I'm going to be honest with you. The Lord illuminated this to me the other day, and he said, yes, he's talking about church problems here, but this is a principle that will deal with any disputes, any conflicts, any fuss, and any fighting, and God gives the answer to it. I want you to know something. These conflicts, this fighting, this fussing, this disintegrating of relationships today is happening at an alarming rate. We live in a day that we enter into relationships like we're going out and buying a car. We're going to go test drive that car. We're going to see if that car works for us. And you know what? If that car doesn't work for us, I'll just turn it in and I'll get another one. But look, when we enter into relationships, they're for the long haul. By the way, if we're going to keep and maintain these relationships, I know all of y'all are shocked, but you're going to have some fussing and fighting and some arguments and disagreements. I think some people have the idea, I'll tell you what, those people that have the greatest marriages, you know, they don't have no problems. You know, they don't have to do anything, you know, they just put everything in cruise control and, you know, they're just kind of, look how much in love they are. Have y'all ever looked at people like that? I have. Can I tell you? They have the same problems you have. They have the same flesh you have. They have the same weaknesses you have. But here's what's amazing. Probably those people that are happily living or living happily married is because they're definitely responding to it the way the Lord wants them to respond to it. So let's just look at this good question with better answers. The cause of conflicts. Why is there so much fuss and fighting, separation, conflict going on today? This is very helpful. And I hope every young person, every child, every teenager, I hope and pray that you will listen with an attempt to really learn something about life here. Because life is about relationships. Let's look at the source of the conflict. Look at verse 1. The Bible says, "From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence even of your lust that war in your members?" The source. So in other words, if we're going to find out what this question's all about is, if you're going to find out, I tell you what, we're just fighting all the time. You know, some couples, they say, I tell you what, we're fighting all the time. Have you ever just thought about, just maybe thinking about, well, why? And maybe there could be some prevention of that fighting. But to prevent it, you got to know the source. If I get strep throat, y'all know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go to the doctor, and that doctor's going to prescribe me some antibiotics. I'm going to take that antibiotics, but I have to be prescribed. I have to be given the medicine that's going to actually help with the problem. And in relationships, there's no difference. There's problems in relationship. There's reasons why people fuss and fight. There's reasons why there's conflict. And God gives us the answers why. Where does this source come from? Number one, you ready? Number one, very simply this, selfish passions. Look what the Bible says, you lust and have not. In other words, y'all are fighting because somebody or both or all are being selfish. You're lusting. Think of this, when Adam and Eve was in the Garden of Eden and they sinned, the Bible, they were perfect. They were sinless. They were in a perfect world. And God had given them just one parameter, said you cannot eat of the tree in the midst of the garden. And yet, the Satan tempted Eve. She took of the fruit and then she gave it to her husband. And when they both took, they had sinned against God. And the Bible said that they became naked. Now, they were always naked, but they didn't see the nakedness because their eyes were open. They had become sinners, and they had to pay for that sin. Jesus Christ came down in the cool of the day to speak with Adam and Eve and said, "Where art thou?" He knew where they were, but he was wanting them to admit what's happened, and they were hiding. Now, they had never hid from God before. What made them hide and cover themselves? Because of their sin. But really, when we think about this, why did Adam and Eve take of that fruit? I'm going to tell you why. They had selfish lust. You know what they thought they could do? They thought they could fulfill the satisfaction of life with something they did, except being content with what God was for them. See, here's what happens. When Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, the Bible states that they died. They died. They started dying physically. They started dying spiritually. They became independent creatures cut off from the life of God. And they had to start satisfying their own desires. The desire to be somebody. By the way, these are the same desires today. I hear it all the time. I tell you what, I want to be somebody. So someone's in a relationship and they don't feel like they are somebody. So they say, I'll tell you what, I can't be somebody in this relationship. So they get out of the relationship. What happened? They become selfish in their lust. And you know what happens when we become selfish and we can't fulfill? We can't fulfill. Because you watch people. They're going from one field to another looking for greener grass and they never find it. All they find is a pig pen. The problem is this world will never satisfy you. And you know why people are fighting and arguing and fussing? You know, I'm going to tell you why? They're frustrated. They're frustrated because they've tried this and that didn't work and they've tried this person and that person didn't work and they've tried this hobby and that hobby didn't make them happy like they thought it was going to make them happy. And what's happened is Adam and Eve got away from just being happy in the Lord Jesus and they started to try to fulfill their own desires and it frustrated them. You know why most relationships are in trouble today? Because they're frustrated. You know why? Because we want. We're not willing to give. We want. Well, what are you going to give me? What are you going to do for me? What are you going to do for me? What are you going to do for me? Do you know? What are you going to do for me? You know, marriage and relationship is not about taking. It's about what? Giving. But if we're selfish, we're not going to give. We're only going to receive. And then we get frustrated when the person that we're married to, look at me now, never adds up. Because I got news for everybody here. Whoever you're with will never add up. You know why? Because I've learned something. My wife's a wonderful lady. I love her. She's the most beautiful thing I've ever laid eyes on. But I've told y'all this. She's failed me and I failed her. And when she married me, she had no idea that what kind of a messes I would make at the house and not clean up. Somebody say amen. You know, honey, there's a hamper there. I know, but I just thought it was there for looks. It looks better with clothes on top of it. That's a pet peeve of hers. But I want you to know something. We're going to have conflict. But look, when we're selfish, think about it. The desire to be loved, the desire to be something worthwhile, and instead of resting in the contentment with all of our needs supplied by God, here's what Adam and Eve did. They entered into a struggle to find life where it doesn't exist. And that's what so many people are doing today. They're trying to find life and happiness and joy in where it will never exist. And we get frustrated. So we start arguing, we start fighting, we get discontented. So we have selfish passion. Number two, we have sinful prayers. Look at it here, verse 2. The Bible says, you lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain, you fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. Why? Because you ask and receive not because you ask amiss. What's that mean? You ask amiss. But the first reason why I believe that we're having a lot of arguing and fighting and fussing and there's a lot of wars in churches and in families and marriages and relationships is why? Because number one, we're just not asking. There's prayerlessness. You know, the most sinful prayer is not one at all. Oh, I'll tell you what, I don't want to go to God again today. This is the 50th time I went to Him. No, He likes it. Could you imagine waking up every day and only speaking to your wife once? That's how many of us, we try to live our life with God. Say, oh, I know He's there, man. Me and the man upstairs, we're tight. But you never talk to Him. Well, I can't tell you that I'm tight with my wife if I don't speak to her. Oh, she knows me so well, she can read my mind. She does know me well, and sadly, I will say to you, many times she reads my mind. And so does God. But you know what? You know what makes a relationship, even though they know it, tell them anyway. Come to them anyway. Why? Because you want to make sure if you come, you're communicating with one another, you're talking, then you're going to have less conflict. These sinful prayer, asking not. You know what prayerlessness is? Here's what prayerlessness is. Prayerlessness is a sign of independence. You say, Pastor, why is independence so bad? Well, here's why when it comes to being a Christian, if you're a Christian and you're not praying, here's what you're saying. God, I really don't need you until the big stuff comes. I really don't need you today, God. I've got it. I'm good. This is the, don't sweat it, God. I got this stuff. This is little. I'm not going to bother you with that. No, God said you're not. You're fighting and warring because you're not praying. You're not asking me. You're not coming to me. He said you're not praying at all. And when we don't pray, here's what we're saying to God. Oh, I'm capable. Look, God, I'm capable of running this thing. I got it. Prayerlessness. James gives us a vital reminder. As long as we look for the fulfillment of life in any other source, and like I said, if I say to God, oh, I got this, God, in other words, I'm saying that I'm the source of my life. Praying is a life of dependence upon the Lord. I'm 46. You would think you'd get wiser when you get older. Well, I'm going to just tell you something. Here's what I've learned. I've learned at the age of 46, I need Him more today than I've ever needed Him in my life. You say, oh, Pastor, you're not much of a man. Well, call me what you want. I can't even walk without Him holding my hand. What we've got to face and what we have to deal with in this day, and just to put another step in front of the other, I have to have Him to help me. I wanted to be dependent upon the Lord. And if someone says, oh, you're using God like a crutch, guilty. I think we'd be better off if we used Him as a crutch. Why? Because we're dependent upon Him. But then they not only pray, they did not pray. Then they said, then God says, you're asking amiss. What does that mean? In other words, they're praying, but they're praying for the wrong motive. Have you ever heard a child pray? And they're praying really loud. Dear Lord, I would really like a train set for Christmas. And someone said, well, honey, why'd you ask so loud? God hears you even if you whisper. He said, I know, but I was praying so Grandma and Grandpa would hear me. And by the way, that's a lot of times why we pray. A lot of reasons that's why we put stuff up on Facebook, so others might know. No, I think I need Him to know. I want Him to know. I want to ask Him. This is to ask with the wrong motive. They asked amiss. Instead of praying and yielding to God's plan on purpose, here it is. It's a prayer to gratify their own desires. In other words, here's what they do. They put a spiritual seal, like a spiritual seal, a stamp of approval on, well, at least it's got a little tinge of spirituality on it. I asked God about it, but the Bible said that they asked amiss. They asked for the wrong reasons. For instance, can I make that how that looks? Can I make that practical? So when you're in an argument with somebody and y'all have had a conflict, say, Lord, would you please just get a hold of her heart? That's the kind of prayer I'm talking about. How about you start here? Lord, will you help me to understand her so I can help her? You know, some people sitting in church, you know, some people's arms are wore slap out, you know. They're sitting there, man, the preacher gets on something, they're like, you know, like, and sometimes it's funny, I don't pay attention to a lot of things, but sometimes I've seen people move and I know it's not the Holy Spirit. But you know, I've seen them jarred a little bit. In other words, that wife, she's ribbing him. You getting this? You getting this? Well, how about you get it? How about I get it? And let me help this real quick. If you're going to talk about spiritualness, like, for instance, when y'all get in your car today and you're driving home, my wife and I's life, our marriage changed in 12 minutes on Sunday. Our whole family's life changed 12 minutes. After church, we had about a 12-minute drive. My two children are sitting here. My wife's sitting here. They'll tell you, there was about every Sunday we would get in that car, and from the time we left church till we got home, we talked about how God spoke to our hearts in the church service, and I would start it out and say, I would not go in there because I knew better than this. I didn't go in there and say, honey, what'd you get out of the message today? What the Holy Spirit really hit on you today? You need to be a better wife, and did he tell you that? No, I got in the car, I said, guys, I need to talk to you a minute. The Lord got a hold of my heart. Would you pray with me? I need to be a better husband, honey. Here's where the Lord showed me that I need to do better there. I'd look at my children and say, I need to be a better father to you children. Here's where the Lord dealt with me on that. Next thing you know, it was amazing. Between that 12 minutes from the time we got in that car till we got to Carnes, all three of us was confessing and communicating and talking. Can I say, fussing in a fight and an argument's come because we're praying for the wrong motives, we're not praying at all, or we're just being selfish. Number two, quickly, can I say the seriousness of compromise? The source comes from fleshly desires and not praying and trying to live and do it on our own. But can I say the seriousness of the compromise? Look at verse 4. Ye adulterers and adulteresses. Man, that's tough language, isn't it? We don't like even using that language anymore. That's pretty tough, isn't it? That's tough. But what's he talking about here? Ye adulterers and adulteresses. Here it is, the seriousness of the compromise. In other words, there's arguments going on, there's fighting going on, and he's talking about the source. The source is that when there's arguments and fight, it's because of a fleshly desire that you're trying to depend upon yourself and other things to create that joy in your life. And the Lord says that if you're a Christian, that you have actually become an adulterer and an adulteress towards Him. You've been unfaithful to Him. Now let me stop here just a minute and say, this kind of living as a Christian, that we're trying to get our joy and trying to get our living from this world and everything else that goes on around it. Listen, the Bible says it resembles infidelity or adultery. It's infidelity. Look at verse 4. The Bible says, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? This thing's serious. You know why? It resembles adultery. Now, what is adultery? It occurs when one person looks outside the exclusive relationship of marriage to get his emotional or her emotional and sexual needs met by a third party that does not belong. That's unfaithfulness. It's adultery. And we know very well what that is. It's a very hurtful thing. The Bible says it's more bitter than death. When a person does it, it's more bitter than death. You hear me? The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, it's more bitter than death. There's a lot that goes along with that, more than just getting caught. There's a lot of emotional, spiritual things that go along with that for years. The Bible says it's more bitter than death. And boy, we like to sit around, we like to talk about people that's done it. And boy, we like to let people know, boy, how bad it is. And by the way, sometimes it's never even been done, but that's what's been said. Boy, we like to sit around and we like to talk about that and we like to throw people under and we don't even know the story. And boy, we like to cast people down. But can I give you something? Physical adultery is horrible, and look here, we don't condone it here because it brings death. Now you say, Pastor, if someone does it, what are you going to do? Look at me now. I'm going to help them. We're going to love them. And look here, we're going to restore them. That's what our church does. You know why our church does that? Because that's what God does. That's what He commands. Though he may fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. We're going to pick the pieces up. We're going to rub the salve on there. We're going to help them. We're going to pick them up. We're going to try to put the pieces together because there's been brokenness there. And by the way, when something, a relationship breaks, nobody wins. There's no winners and no losers. Everybody loses. We live in a day where, boy, we like to find fault. I tell you right now, I blame it on that. Put it on that. Listen to me. God says this, living without God is like adultery. What's that mean? Well, we all know what physical adultery is. I just explained it. But let me help y'all some. What about spiritual adultery? Oh, we never talk about that. We never say, oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. What's spiritual adultery? Y'all ready? It occurs when Christians look outside their relationship to God to get their needs met, and a third party, like the world, is invited in that shouldn't be there. That's adultery. Can I ask y'all a question? Y'all ever been unfaithful to the Lord as a Christian? We all have. We've committed spiritual adultery. Very little said about it. It might not make the news. It might not make someone's texting conversation. But nonetheless, it sure does cause a lot of fight and fussings and disputes and separations because we're just simply embracing the world. It's like inviting a hated friend to come in and come right on in and invite them to dinner, and we think that's not going to have an effect on my home, my relationship, my marriage. No, the Bible says it's going to cause fightings and disputings and conflict. When we crave acceptance from the world and reject God and set ourselves up thinking this world and anything it has to do that's going to satisfy up, we've just plotted a life of absolutely dependence and saying, Lord, we know we're saved. We know you've saved us, but you know what? We got it down here. We'll talk to you a little bit on Sunday. We might talk to you a little bit here and there when I get in trouble, but as far as me living this life, you stay out of it. That's adultery. That's spiritual adultery. You know why? Because you're not being faithful to Him. Now, how long would your wife put up with that? How long would your husband put up with that? How long? How long would they put up with it? How long would that relationship stay right? Let's say you was friends and you were backstabbing your friend and you were one way to your friend and then next thing you know, you go somewhere else, you talk bad about that friend and you're being unfaithful to that friend in emotions. How long if that friend found out about it? How long is that going to last? Is that not going to harm your relationship? Well, if we want to guard our physical relationships as we should, our greatest one to guard is mine with Him. Why? Because it causes fightings and disputings. Can I teach everybody a great lesson here? It's simple, but if you'll learn it, it'll be life-changing. Do you know when I have my biggest struggle with my wife? Do you know when and we've been married 28 years. Do you know when her and I struggle the most in our relationship? When one of our relationships struggling with the Lord. You really think I can be the husband that she deserves if I don't have the right relationship with the Lord? I'm not going to forgive her like I should. Who wants to forgive anybody? Your flesh is, oh, I'm ready to get up and let somebody hurt me today and I want to forgive them. Nobody gets up like that. But who helps you do that? Well, if you're saved, the Spirit of God helps you do it. Amen. It resembles adultery. Hey, can I say this quickly? It reveals our arrogance. The Bible says in verse 6, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace. What is the meaning of grace? What is grace? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Thank God for grace. You know what that means? That means that I don't deserve grace. I deserve punishment. I deserve hell, but God extended grace. He gave me something I don't deserve. Aren't y'all thankful for that? But you know what? We get fuzzy-minded when it comes. We believe in grace to get saved. And by the way, if you're here today and you do not know the Lord Jesus, I'm not offering you religion. Religion has never saved anybody. But listen to me. If you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, listen to me, you don't even know what life is all about yet. You're just existing. When you enter into a relationship with the Lord Jesus, and He walks with me, and He talks with me, and He tells me I am His own, and the joy we share as we tarry there. Listen, Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship with the Lord Jesus. And if you don't know Him today, you need to experience His grace. We'll give an opportunity in the service. If I was here and I didn't know Christ my Savior, I'd get saved today. If I didn't know 100% sure if I died I was going to heaven, I tell you right now, there wouldn't be anything keep me from getting it right today. I can promise you that. But I want to say grace, we know that about salvation. We all understand grace. But what about this grace to just to live? God said He giveth more grace to the who? The humble. The meaning of grace. He gives grace to the humble. Listen, I want you to understand that God gives more grace. He's ready to help us in all of our struggles of life. He'll help us. He'll do things that we cannot do for ourselves. He'll strengthen us. He'll help us and give us aid in difficult, struggling relationships. He gives grace. What's the means of grace? The Bible says He gives it to the humble. Now, here's where we need to stop, and we're going to close here in just a minute. I'm not going to get to the end. We'll finish tonight. What's the means of grace? What does it mean? Why is this so important? The means of grace. In other words, He gives grace to the humble. Can I ask you this question? Are you humble? Just answer that in your mind. Are you a humble person? Can I give you a little test to take, see whether you are or not? If you're in a relationship, if you're humble, you're always trying to figure out what you can do better to make your relationship better, not what somebody else has to do to make it better. Humble means you're ready to submit to the help. And by the way, I'm not going to make a big deal about it, but now listen, I don't know everything about it, but Mr. Dellen, I asked him the other day, I said, what's his name? We call him Dellen Tyler, and I was very clearly said, it's Dellen. I was like, yes. That's one thing. I mean, you know, when a guy comes in your office, and somebody comes in your office, I mean, first of all, nobody wants to come to the pastor's office. Somebody say amen. You know, I mean, I've never had somebody just come in my office very rarely and say, hey, pastor, I just really wanted to come. Well, I can't say that all the time, but very rarely someone come in and say, hey, I just wanted to be around you today. You know, they're usually, why are they coming in there? They're coming in there because they want to ask, and that's great. I enjoy the fellowship. But I'm going to tell you something right now. When I start realizing, because I'm always trying to judge, is this person playing games or are they being real? Because I'm going to be honest, you say, pastor, you look, y'all don't know how many times we've been played. But I'm constantly doing that. But I'm going to tell you a real quick way how you can sniff it out real quick. Y'all ready? When somebody actually admit that they're wrong. And the ones that never will. By the way, if you have a marriage and you think you're perfect in it, you're already in a mess. If you think you've done no wrong, you're already in trouble. I've heard someone say not long ago, well, I tell you what, I wouldn't change anything. I've done everything right. I'm going to be honest with you, I wanted to throw up. You know why? Because look here, it takes two to tango. And by the way, if there's trouble or conflict in your marriage, the love bank has went negative somewhere. You better find out where it's getting negative at. You can't withdraw so much and not put back. The account gets so low, the next thing you know, normally what you have to do is you got to go look for other funds. And that's when a marriage gets in trouble. So again, the key there is look for the prevention. What am I doing that I could do better to help my relationship? You know what that takes, though? It takes humility. It's me, Lord. It's me. A soft answer turneth away wrath. Follow me, Brother Nathan. I'm coming down. I'm going to hurry and get over here in the middle. This is my wife. We've been married 28 years. Almost. And it amazes me, we've had arguments, haven't we? Good ones. And there has been times I've wanted to have them. I've been in that mood. Have y'all ever got in that mood? If you don't raise your hand, you're lying again in church. But you know, it's awful hard to fight when someone looks at you and say, honey, I love you. And what you're getting ready to say, I forgive you anyway. That just kind of takes the fight right out of you. You know why that's true? Because the Bible's always right. A soft answer turneth away wrath. You know why we argue? Because we don't use soft answers. We try to get our point across. We're so selfish, we're not even listening to what our spouse or our friend or our family member is saying. We only want them to hear what we're saying. And then we wonder why we have so many conflicts and fights. Humility says, what can I do? Honey, what have I done? Get ready, though. Now listen, if you go be man enough to say that, you better be man enough to take it. Honey, what can I do better? Because if she loves you, she's going to tell you what you can do better. And you need to be a man about it, and you need to say, you know what, I appreciate you loving me enough to tell me that. Why can't we talk like this anymore? People want to get on Facebook and throw out a bunch of hurtful stuff and not sit down in an office and talk about it. When people do that, all they're doing is revealing. They don't want to fix nothing. You hear me? So I'm going to help everybody. Don't use social media to hurt people. And it hurts. It hurts deeply. And sometimes people say, well, just because you don't put anything up. No, it's a lot harder not to put things up. But the Lord will help us. Because why? Our goal is we want to restore relationships. So let's communicate. Let's talk. Let's be humble. Honey, I'm sorry. Some people, you know, like, just say it. It's like you just will put, just say it. It won't kill you. I'm sorry. Some people, y'all ever watch the Andy Griffith Show? I thought I've seen all of them. The other day I watched one, I'd never seen it. But you know, there was a couple on there fighting. I mean, they was fighting. They was fighting about the silliest stuff. So old Andy Griffith, you know, it amazed me. He was the sheriff. He was the justice of the peace. But he was also a marriage counselor. It was amazing. So he gets this couple there, and he gets sitting there and starts talking to them. And this one old man, he's a country farmer. I mean, just as country hillbilly as can be. And, you know, he said, well, I told her I loved her when I got married. If anything changed, I'll let her know. He said, no. He said, look, you're not talking to each other right. And so I'll never forget that episode. Y'all know which one I'm talking about? And they're sitting there talking, and he's like, okay, now you look at your wife there and say, yes, dear. And that old boy, I mean, it's like he couldn't say it. Yes, honey. And it's like, couldn't even say it. And I've learned the same kind. I've learned, Brother Sexton, in 46 years of life, people are scared to death to say, I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? You know what? Nothing will ever get fixed till you realize there's a problem. Nothing can ever be healed until you realize something's broken. And I've had to come to this humility in my life. Sometimes when I thought it was her, it was actually me. He giveth grace to the humble, but he resisteth the proud. Now think of that. He resisteth the proud. Are you proud? Am I proud? Do you know I have seen relationships deteriorate and go away because someone is not humbled enough to say, I'm sorry. What relationship are you worth sacrificing because you won't be humbled? God giveth more grace to the humble. The humble. It's me, Lord. It's me, Lord. It's me, Lord. Will you help me? Here I come again, Lord. I need your help. I failed again, Lord. Will you help me? Humble. He giveth grace to the humble. Give you one little quiz. Is your spouse afraid to come to you, or your friend afraid to come to you to tell you something you need to really hear, and they're scared to death to tell you because they know you're going to get mad? Let's stop right there just a minute. Are you the kind of person that you think your spouse is afraid, or your friend or your family member is afraid to come to you and talk to you about something very important and maybe how they've been hurt or something is hurting them in that relationship, but they're too afraid to talk to you because you'll blow up on them and get mad? Then you're full of pride. The people that you love the most should be the people that you let in the most and let them talk to you and not be so full of pride that you can't take reproof. You say, Pastor Mark, why are you dealing with these things? Because we have fightings and wars and conflict and fussing and disintegrating of families, and the answers are so simple. I didn't say they're easy to do, but they're simply laid out. If we would just let the Lord help us to respond to those conflicts, to those struggles, to those hurts. God's way always works. Amen. If you're here today and you do not know Jesus Christ your Savior, I'm begging you today, trust Him today. Look, nothing has been more precious in life. Think about it. We've lived in very interesting days. Interesting year. What was to happen if you took your last breath? You ever thought about it? Where would you go? Where would you spend eternity? The Lord wants you to have peace and to know Him as your Savior. If you do not know Him, you can trust Him today. We'll help you. We'll take the Bible. We'll have someone take the Bible, and they'll not give you their opinion. They'll show you straight from the Bible how to be saved. I would not walk out of this building if I did not know Christ. Let's stand to our feet. I'm going to ask Mr. Dillon to come forward if he would. And I'm going to have him come just for a minute. I'm going to give him an opportunity to go and get. But I'd like for you to, if you would, just stand right here for me a minute. This is Mr. Dillon. And Dillon, you know the Lord Jesus Christ has saved you from your sins. And you've trusted Him as your personal Savior. And you want to follow Him in believer's baptism. And I'm thankful you have some family here. We're glad y'all are here. Thank y'all for being here for this gentleman. And I have enjoyed being with this guy. We're going to keep having some conversations. But I'm so encouraged that he wants to follow the Lord in baptism. Now I want to say this. If there's anyone here and you've trusted Christ as your Savior, you need to follow the Lord in baptism. And I would do it sooner rather than later. And we'll talk to you about it. But they're going to go on and get back and get ready, so to make it quicker. But while they're going and getting ready, I want to ask you this question. With head bowed and eyes closed, and Brother Don's going to give a song here in just a moment. But could we just, for a moment, could we just ponder our lives, our relationships? Where are they? Now, I'm not going to ask you to do anything. I'm going to ask you to do this one thing, but I'm not going to ask you to do anything else other than this one thing. How many of you know the Lord Jesus Christ spoke to your heart about something and it was so very helpful? Would you be honest? If you would, you could slip up your hand. I would like to pray for you. You say, God spoke to me about something. That's wonderful. The second thing I'm going to ask, and I'm not going to ask you to do anything other than come and talk to me after church. You say, Pastor Mark, I'm here today and I don't know for sure if I die, I'm going to heaven. I don't know for sure if I die, I'm going to heaven. You know, it amazes me. We live in a day where people will spend a year to make plans for a vacation, but they've not given one second thought of where they're going to spend eternity. Do you know Christ as your Savior? If you do not, would you please, please come and see me after the service? I would like to show you from the Word of God how to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You'll never regret it. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your goodness and grace. Be with us now in Jesus' name.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for Christ that I have done? He groaned up on the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well might the sun in darkness hide, and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty Maker died for a man, the creature sin. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. Well, this is Dellen Ward. We praise God for him. And Mr. Dellen is coming to make a profession of faith in the Lord Jesus. But now he wants to follow the Lord in baptism. So my brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life.
And now when you say amen.
How many of you have been encouraged by him doing this today?
Amen.
Please, none of the family leave. I want to meet all of you. I know Dad, but I want to meet everybody, so please don't leave. And God bless you. You may stand to your feet. Children, we're glad y'all are in here to see that. And as we say often, baptism does.